Hello students, I am Dr. Aruna Palta from Raipur, Chhattisgarh. Today we will be discussing a very interesting topic of food science which I think everyone should know about, as it has got a lot of importance in culinary science as well as in our day-to-day life. Today I will be talking about colloidal dispersions, their properties, differences between a colloidal dispersion, true solution and suspension, sol-gel transformation process, what are emulsions, their formation, types, and lastly about the factors that affect the stability of emulsions. So, this module on emulsions and colloids in the paper Food Science will surely help you to understand colloids and to know about colloidal dispersions, to learn the properties of colloidal system, to observe the differences between a colloidal dispersion, solution and suspension, to know about the sol-gel transformation process, to know what is an emulsion and learn the process of its formation, to learn about the various types of emulsions and the factors affecting their stability. Students, I would like to tell you that food is a complex material containing a high percentage of water in which other materials are dispersed. Thomas Graham was known as father of colloidal chemistry, and he was the first one to find out the existence of colloidal state. He classified the organic compounds present in food into two categories, the colloids and the crystalloids. Now, the colloidal chemistry deals with dispersed system of a definite size because it is the size of the particle in the colloidal range that imparts the specific characteristic properties that are not explained by the laws governing solid, liquid or gaseous states of matter. A diagram showing the size of the colloidal particles as compared to water molecule. We can definitely see that colloidal particles, their size is bigger than that of water molecule, which is made of two hydrogens and one oxygen. Again, we can see the colloidal particle size in comparison to other particles. The first one is hydrogen atom particle, quite smaller than the colloidal particle. Then average molecules, even they are smaller than colloidal particle. The colloidal particle is only smaller than the visible particles which form suspension, which is evident from this diagram. Now we will talk about colloids and colloidal dispersions. I would like to tell you that the word colloid is derived from the Greek word colla, which means glue. Colloidal system contains particles of a definite size range with the lower limits as 1 millimicron and the upper limit as 0.1 micron. Colloids are particles with large molecular weight which form dispersions with water, for example proteins, glycogen, starch, agar-agar, etc. Crystalloids, on the other hand, are compounds with small molecular weight which can form true solutions. Some of the examples are sugars and amino acids. The particles above 0.1 micron are generally visible and form suspensions with water. On the screen, you can see different particle sizes. The smaller particles, they are forming true solution with particle size less than 1 millimicron. The second, you can see the part is colloidal solution with the particle size range from 1 millimicron to 0.1 micron. And lastly, you can see the bigger particles of suspension having particle size range above than 1.1 micron. The particles in colloidal range do not behave alike. The properties of colloidal particles around 1 micron size are different from those approaching 0.1 millimicron. Thus, particles approaching the limits of the size range of one zone may show properties of two zones. For example, sugar may exhibit both crystalloidal as well as colloidal properties in various foods. The gluten particles of bread flour protein have colloidal dimension, but the gluten formed from cake and pastry flours are more dispersed or of smaller size than those from bread flours. The more obvious of these differences can be observed by preparing dispersions of glucose, starch, and cellulose in water. Each of these has the same elementary composition. Glucose, C6H12O6, starch and cellulose also C6H12O6, but a larger size, N, which denotes the number, but the size of the particles differ. If 1 gram of each is mixed with 100 ml of cold water, glucose gives a true solution, while both starch and cellulose, they give suspensions. Now, if they are heated to 100 degrees centigrade and then cooled, glucose remains a true solution. Cellulose remains a suspension, but starch suspension converts to a colloidal dispersion. Thus, we can say that the degree of dispersion has been altered by applying heat. Similar alterations in systems occur in the presence of alkali, in the presence of acids, enzymes, and even by mechanical means like beating, stirring, grinding, etc. Classification of colloidal systems. Colloidal systems are not restricted to the dispersion of a solid in a liquid. All the three states of matter, solid, liquid, or gas can be dispersed in a medium, which may be again solid, liquid, or gas. Thus, colloidal systems can occur in 8 different combinations. Mixture of gases, they do not form colloidal mixture, they form solutions. Again, colloidal systems can be classified into lyophilic, that is solvent loving, and lyophobic, that is solvent repelling colloids on the basis of their relative affinity of the dispersed phase in the dispersion medium. If the affinity of the dispersed phase and the dispersion medium is high, the colloid is termed as lyophilic. Gelatin, gum, pectins, proteins of egg yolk, skim milk, they are all examples of lyophilic group. But if the degree of affinity of the dispersed phase and the dispersion medium is slight, the colloid is termed as lyophobic. If the solvent is water, then the colloids are termed as hydrophilic and hydrophobic respectively. Now we will look into the properties of colloidal system. The first property is Tyndall effect. When a strong beam of light is passed through a colloidal dispersion, due to deflection from the surface of colloidal particles, it leaves a bright definite path. This only is known as the Tyndall effect. Though colloidal particles are not visible, but their presence and movements may be detected by the nature of reflection. You can see the effect, Tyndall effect, on the screen. There are two beakers of solutions. One is the true solution, other one is the colloidal dispersion. And when the beam of light passes through both the beakers, you can see in the colloidal dispersion that the pathway can be easily identified. This is just due to the presence of colloidal particles in the colloidal dispersion. While in the solution, this pathway of light is not visible. Brownian movement. This is an important property brought about by the bombardment of thousands of molecules in the liquid or a gas in which the colloidal particles are suspended. This molecular movement, also known as Brownian movement, helps in stabilization of colloidal dispersion. Colloidal particles of smaller size show more vigorous Brownian motion. This slide on the screen is showing you the Brownian motion of a colloidal particle. Electric charge. Colloidal particles are electrically charged. Some colloidal particles carry a positive charge, while others a negative one. The ionized group of proteins and phospholipids can be the sources of the charge. In the presence of a small quantity of dissolved electrolyte, salt particles selectively adsorb ions of one type from the solution. This adsorption of ions is a major factor in stabilizing a colloidal dispersion. Since the ions in a given colloidal system have the same charge, they repel each other and hence the tendency to collapse is reduced. This diagram is showing the presence of electric charge on the colloidal particles. You can very well see a layer of positive charges on the fixed layer of positive charges on the colloidal particle, while you can also see a diffused layer of negative charges around the positive charge layer. Thus, a colloidal particle has got two layers of charges. The first layer is of fixed charges and the opposite layer of negative charges is around the fixed layer. Adsorption. Colloidal particles attract and hold to their surfaces the molecules of vapors, gases, and other matter with which they come in contact. This only is known as adsorption. The particles acquire an electric charge due to adsorption, which governs the stability of colloid. Again, there is a figure showing the adsorption on colloidal particles. Actually, the charges, the ions, they are adsorbed on the colloidal particles, and this adsorption only is responsible for the charges of colloidal particles. Imbibitions, this is one of the property of the colloidal system, and this is the ability of the colloids to pick up water and swell when they come in contact with water. Added materials such as acids and alkalis, they have a marked effect on the degree of swelling. And in this process of imbibition, heat is generally evolved. Viscosity and plasticity. Various degrees of viscosity and plasticity are encountered in colloids. Viscosity may be described as resistance to pouring. The property of solids that enables them to hold their shape under small pressure is known as plasticity. Colloidal system range in degree of viscosity and plasticity according to the environmental factors. The viscosity of a colloidal system is definitely affected by temperature. It has been observed that with an increase in temperature, the viscosity decreases. For example, milk becomes less viscous at high temperatures. Colloidal gels as gelatin and agar are less viscous at high temperatures than low ones. The viscosity of a colloid also increases with the concentration and aggregation of dispersed particles. Let us see, for example, when there is an increase in the number and aggregation of fat particles, the cream becomes more viscous. Increased amount of protein solids, they also bring about an increase in viscosity. Thus, the viscosity of custard is related to the amount of egg protein dispersed in the liquid. Students, now we will see the destabilization of colloidal system. The stability of a colloidal system is defined by particles remaining suspended in solution at equilibrium. Stability is affected by aggregation and sedimentation processes, which are driven by the tendency of the colloids to reduce surface energy. Reducing the interfacial tension will stabilize the colloidal system by reducing this driving force. This can be accomplished by a number of methods. On the screen, you can see the destabilization of colloidal system. First one is the example of a stable colloid, where you can see the colloidal particles which are distributed in the dispersion media. And the second one is the example of an unstable colloid, where you can find that the colloidal particles, they are either in the form of aggregates or even sedimentation is seen in the second figure. It has been observed that removal of the electrical charges, they prevent the aggregation of the particles. This can be done by the addition of salt or even by changing the pH of the colloidal system to neutralize the surface charge of the particles. This removes the repulsive forces that keep the colloidal particles separate and allows for coagulation. Lyophobic salts are mostly destabilized by this method only. Charged particles, they have a strong attraction for the polar water molecules and therefore are hydrated, probably having a complete envelope of water molecules. Addition of salt helps in the withdrawal of the water from the hydrated surface of the particles, and this helps in precipitation. Lyophilic salts are mostly destabilized by removing the water envelope from the colloidal particles. Physical deformation of the particle, like stretching and heating, may result into coagulation of colloidal system at certain orientations. Brownian motion to a certain extent may also help in allowing the colloidal particles to run apart from each other, preventing their aggregation. Now we will come to salts, gels and suspension. A colloidal system in which solid particles are dispersed in a liquid is referred to as a sol. In a true solution, the substance separates into molecules and ions that disperse homogeneously throughout the volume of the solvent. But when a protein such as gelatin is dispersed in water, the solution-like mixture that results is a sol. Examined under a microscope, the individual protein particles are large enough to be distinguished from the dispersion medium. Salts resemble liquids in their main physical properties, that is, they flow and they do not show rigidity of form. However, when a sol assumes a rigid form, it is referred to as a gel. There is no distinct line of separation between a sol and a gel. In fact, some salts become gel by increasing the concentration of dispersed solids. A typical sol is a fluid, whereas a typical gel has a certain amount of rigidity. By the reduction in the number of charged particles and adjustment of pH or addition of salt, a sol can be transformed into a gel. Addition of sugar, which competes with water in the continuous phase, helps gel formation when used in the proper portion. Change in temperature has an effect on gel formation. Low temperatures, they reduce the mobility of the colloidal molecules in the sol and increase the viscosity. This condition facilitates gel formation. The rigidity of gel changes with time, reaching to senescence, which involves release of water and contraction of gel volume. The amount of liquid released varies with the type of gel and the conditions under which it is prepared. Suspensions. When the particles of a solid are separated into large aggregates of particles and dispersed in a liquid, the food system is referred to as a suspension. In a suspension, the particles tend to sink to the bottom of the mixture if they are heavier than the liquid, but rise to the top if they are lighter. A mixture of flour and water is an example of a mixture in which the particles are heavier than the liquid. If it is stirred and heated, a suspension of this kind will change to a gel. So, it must be clear that both solid and suspension are solid and liquid dispersions, but with different particle size. Particle size above 0.1 micron forms suspension, but between 1 millimicron to 0.1 micron form sol. Now we will talk about emulsions. A true emulsion represents a colloidal dispersion of one liquid in another when both liquids are mutually immiscible. Emulsions exhibit the characteristics of colloidal systems, the particle of the dispersed phase being about 0.1 micron. The liquid in which the dispersion takes place is called the continuous phase. Mayonnaise, which is a liquid in liquid dispersion, is an example of a true emulsion. A food emulsion is basically a two-phase system consisting of two liquids such as oil and water. An emulsion has three parts: dispersed phase, continuous phase, and emulsifier. Emulsifier, it is a surface active agent that decreases interfacial tension and forms physical barriers around each droplet to impede their coalescence. Students, this is the diagram of three phases of an emulsion. You can see that in the beaker there is an emulsion in which the continuous phase is of water, which is acting as a dispersion medium. Then there are droplets of oil in it, and around the oil particle you can find a complete covering of the emulsifier. Thus we can very well understand that an emulsion has got three phases: the water phase, the oil phase, and even the third one is the emulsifier. During sol-gel transformation, a three-dimensional network is formed by the interlocking of dispersed particles. The liquid phase is entrapped in the interstitial areas of this structure. When this happens, the sol loses its fluidity and it becomes a gel. The change from sol to gel may be brought about by a change in the concentration of dispersed phase or a change in temperature. Gelatin dispersed in hot water is a sol, but when it is cooled, it becomes rigid, transparent gel. Other examples of sols that turn to gels are fruit jellies and custards. Many gels, they lose liquid upon standing and the gel structure shrinks. This is called weeping of gel or cinereses. So this is the figure of a water in oil emulsion. We can very well see that the yellow portion, that is the continuous phase made up of oil. The blue circles, they are in fact the water phase or the water droplets in oil. And you can see pink color balls with spiral tails. This is in fact the emulsifier molecule. The pink part, that is the polar part of the emulsifier, and the black spiral tail is in fact the non-polar part of the emulsifier. The non-polar part it binds the oil phase, and the pink polar head, it gets connected to the water molecule, and thus this emulsifier, it helps in the stabilization of this water in oil emulsion. Now we will talk about inversion. The phases in an emulsion may be exchanged by a process known as phase inversion. A common example of phase inversion in foods is butter, where cream is converted to butter by a process involving concentration and agitation. When the sufficient oil concentration has been achieved, the agitation brings about a conversion of the oil in water emulsion of cream to the water in oil emulsion of butter. In the process, the oil concentration is further increased by the elimination of more aqueous phase as buttermilk. In general terms, the more stable form is determined by concentration. Students, here you can see the figure of some hydrophilic and hydrophobic colloids which are stabilized by emulsifiers. You can see that when a polar or water group, it combines with non-polar or fat group, both of them, when they combine and they are just shaken or stirred, an emulsion is formed, but this emulsion is not stable. You can see very well that the oil phase and the water phase, they separate. But in the lower part, you see that when water is combined with oil in the presence of an emulsifier, which can be egg or any other emulsifier, when they combine together and when you prepare a proper emulsion out of it, then you can find that a stable emulsion or a stable mixture is formed. In nature, you can see some stable emulsions in the form of milk, cream, and many such substances. Now we will talk about emulsifiers. The most common method of preparing an emulsion is by mechanically dispersing one liquid phase in another by formation of small droplets with the help of a beater blade. A stable emulsion is not formed by merely mixing of the liquids. When the emulsion is left to stand, droplets in the dispersed phase collapse due to surface tension. It is possible, however, to stabilize an emulsion by adding a suitable substance termed as emulsifier. Emulsifiers may be in the form of proteins, gums, gels, fatty acids, and phospholipids. Materials used as emulsifiers have an electric charge opposite to that of the material to which they are added. So here on the screen, you can see some emulsifiers and stabilizers. Emulsifiers, they have got both polar group and non-polar group. And two basic type of emulsifiers can be amino acid chains and phospholipids like lecithin. And they are also known as surfactants because they decrease the surface tension. Some common emulsifiers can be egg yolks, which contain lecithin and proteins, milk and cream, which contain casein protein, and mustard, which has got a lot of mucilage in the seed coating. Similarly, there are stabilizers also, which can stabilize the emulsions. They are generally large molecules, which can act as stabilizers like proteins, starch, pectins, plant particles, food gums, because these large molecules can very well stabilize the fat molecule. And these stabilizers, they increase the viscosity of the emulsion. And when the emulsion becomes thick, it becomes stable also. This only is the reason why xanthan gum is used as a stabilizer in a number of emulsions. Emulsions are basically of two types. Oil and water emulsions, where the dispersed phase is oil, and water in oil emulsion, where the dispersed phase is water. The oil and water emulsion consists of liquid droplets dispersed in water. Examples of this type is milk, cream, ice cream, mayonnaise, and other salad dressings. The water in oil emulsion is made up of water droplets dispersed in oil. Example of this type, butter and margarine. Food emulsions must have the appropriate appearance, that is color plus opacity, or appropriate texture, which consists of viscosity, plasticity and oiliness, and definitely an appropriate flavor which helps it for acceptance. Students, I would like to tell you that the emulsifier reduces the interfacial tension existing between the water and the oil, thus making them less repellent to each other. This can be accomplished because one end of the emulsifier, which is the polar end, it is soluble in water, and the other end, which is the non-polar end, is soluble in oil. The emulsifier reduces the interfacial tension existing between the water and the oil, thus making them less repellent to each other. This permits a film to form around each tiny drop of oil that prevents the drops from running together. There are many emulsifiers which are present in nature, such as phospholipids. Example of it is lecithin, which is present in egg yolk, which acts as a natural emulsifier and is generally used in stabilizing mayonnaise emulsion. Now, hydrocolloids such as plant gums and gelatin, they also act stabilizers in oil and water emulsions just by increasing the viscosity of the continuous phase, or sometimes by forming a strong interfacial film around droplets of the dispersed phase. Examples are lecithin, alginates, plant and seed gums, and cellulose derivatives like carboxymethyl cellulose and hydroxypropyl. Emulsions, they may also be stabilized by a process known as homogenization. In this process, the size of the dispersed fat globules is greatly reduced to more or less uniform diameter by application of considerable force. This prevents the fat globules from collapsing. This is the diagram showing the stability of emulsion. In the first test tube, you can see the separate water phase and oil phase. They are just homogenized and a primary emulsion is formed. And this primary emulsion is not very stable. To make it stable, we can add biopolymers. After adding biopolymers and homogenizing, again, a stable emulsion is formed, which is known as the secondary emulsion, which has got two layers of protection around the particle, and thus this emulsion becomes stable. On the screen, students, you can see the animation of a stable emulsion, stabilization of colloidal system. Students, first we have seen the destabilization of colloidal system. Now we will talk about the stabilization of colloidal system. The stability of a colloidal system is defined by particles remaining suspended in solution at equilibrium. Stability is hindered by aggregation and sedimentation phenomena, which are driven by the colloid's tendency to reduce surface energy. Reducing the interfacial tension will stabilize the colloidal system by reducing this driving force. So, dear students, now we come to the end of this module, and I would like to summarize by saying that a colloidal system is a heterogeneous system consisting of two phases, the dispersed phase and the dispersion medium. Eight types of colloidal dispersions can be formed from the three states of matter, solid, liquid and gaseous state. Colloidal particles are electrically charged and are in Brownian motion and generally have an envelope of water molecule around them. Colloidal system may be either lyophilic or lyophobic. Rigid colloidal systems are termed as gel. Emulsion is also a colloidal dispersion of two mutually immiscible liquids. Emulsifiers are surface active agents which help in stabilization of emulsions. Emulsifiers have strong polar as well as strong nonpolar groups. Homogenization also stabilizes emulsions by reducing the size of the particles. Colloidal system is destabilized by neutralizing electric charges, by dehydrating influences, and also by physical means to a lesser extent. Thank you.